Welcome to our show, That's So Chratheist. So what does Chratheist mean? Well, it's a word that I made up. It's a mixture of two other words, Christian and atheist. And it's to show that it's possible for Christians and atheists to talk in a respectable way. My name is Truman Ardent Smith. I'm a former evangelical Christian. I was raised as a Roman Catholic, and after college, I became a born-again evangelical Christian. For about 25 years after that, I practiced Christianity, evangelical Christianity. I preached the gospel on local cable TV and the internet, and I even started a part-time 501c3 ministry to preach the gospel on the internet and local TV. Then in 2009, I left the faith and I became an atheist. So in this show series, what I do is I have a number of guests who are active in some role as evangelical Christians who are experts in matters of science and or religion. This is a special interest of mine because I left evangelical Christianity for scientific reasons, especially having to do with neuroscience and evolution. Today my guest is Ted Davis. Ted served as a president of the ASA, which is the American Scientific Affiliation, a couple years ago, in around 2010. He's currently professor of the history of science at Messiah College, which is in Pennsylvania. It's a Christian college. And he teaches courses on historical and contemporary aspects of Christianity and science. He's also a contributor to the Biologos website. So welcome to the show, Ted.
Well, thank you very much, Truman.
So to start with, is there anything else you want to say about your credentials in case somebody says, who is this guy, or I didn't introduce you, or did I miss anything?
No, what you said is fine. That pretty much covers it.
Okay, and also before we get started, I wonder if you can briefly talk about what Biologos is and also the ASA, because I think these are really actually two very important organizations that Christians should be involved in. So can you briefly explain what those organizations are doing?
Yes, thanks for the opportunity to talk about them. The organizations are quite different in their emphases, in their purposes. Let me start with the American Scientific Affiliation. That's the one that I was president of for a brief period. I was an officer for several years, 1 year as president. That's an organization founded in 1941 that is for Christians in the sciences. And its purpose is really to provide fellowship for Christians in the sciences, also to provide a home for a scholarly journal about Christianity and science, called Perspectives on Science and Christian Faith, and also to sponsor various activities such as an annual meeting and local regional meetings in parts of the country. The Biologos, on the other hand, is a relatively recent organization started by Francis Collins, who's now head of the National Institutes of Health. It's intended to promote the view that evolution and Christian faith are compatible.
Okay, yeah, and I met you probably about 5 years ago or so. I was a member of the ASA also. So basically, for people who have some kind of a science degree or equivalent, they're invited to join that. And I've been to a couple of the conferences, and they're really dominated by people in academia, either a lot of Christians that are professors or people with PhDs. I've noticed that too. So I kind of felt actually out of place at some of these conferences, but it's nice to have a place, I think, for Christian professionals to get together and talk to other Christian professionals.
Well, right? It's an odd kind of organization in this way. It is a fellowship of Christians in the sciences, but it is also an academic society that publishes a refereed academic journal. Many universities get this in their libraries. So okay. It's not the same thing as, for example, a local church. Many people who are in a local church wouldn't feel comfortable at an ASA meeting because it's more academic in its orientation. If you don't really have a strong interest in science and Christian faith, you're not going to feel like it's for you.
Right. And if you do have a very strong interest in science and maybe how that interacts with theology, then that would be a perfect place for you, right?
Yes, it would.
Okay, so we're going to have just a general discussion for about an hour or so based on Ted's work. And then at the end, I have a time reserved. Well, I'll give a minute summary of kind of what I thought we talked about, and I'll give Ted the last word to give a minute summary also. And then I'm going to spend about a minute talking about gatherings in the local area. So to start with, Ted, so basically your expertise is studying the science and religion interface. And I'll read the question this way. You're a historian of science and religion, and one of the topics you've written about is the warfare view of the history of science and religion. So maybe if you can talk about that a little bit, and then after you give your a little presentation, not a lecture, but putting out your ideas, I'll take some notes and then I'll ask some follow-up questions on that, because I have a feeling that we have opposite viewpoints here, so it should be an interesting show, I think.
Yeah, well, when a historian such as myself talks about the warfare view, what we mainly mean, what we usually mean, is a view that develops in the late 19th century in the United States. The people that are associated with this are especially a man named John William Draper, who was a professor at what's now called New York University, and then another person called Andrew Dixon White. He was actually the first president of Cornell University. There's even a hall at Cornell today named for him, A.D. White Hall. Their perspectives were not identical, but overall they held a view that Christianity and science were opposing cultural forces, and that science was going eventually to triumph over Christianity. Let me give you, for example, one short statement of Draper's viewpoint. He wrote the following. This is a sentence from one of Draper's books. The book is called History of the Conflict Between Religion and Science. The title pretty much gets it. Here's how he spelled it out. The history of science is not a mere record of isolated discoveries. It is a narrative of the conflict of two contending powers, the expansive force of the human intellect on one side, and the compression arising from traditionary faith and human interest on the other. In short, he opposed one to the other. White did pretty much the same thing, and the title of his famous book is similar. It's called A History of the Warfare of Science with Theology in Christendom. So that's a start. We can talk more about that, but you might want to interject a question or two at this point.
Yeah, so I guess some questions or comments I have is, you said this kind of started in the late 19th century, but isn't the reason for that is because that's when science really started to blossom? I mean, for example, in the year 200 or 300, there was no science to have a conflict. In fact, you would say the Bible was written and understood with their current idea of science. So as we learned more about science, that's why we have a conflict.
Well, that's a view that some modern scientists would certainly hold. Historically, though, the view that I'm referring to as the warfare view is a specific take on this. And it is something that is associated with those two men from the late 19th century. It has roots earlier. Enlightenment, some French Enlightenment philosophers held an even stronger view of the warfare, close to what Richard Dawkins holds today, in which religion itself is a bad idea, a virus that needs to be eradicated, as Dawkins puts it. That wasn't what Draper and White thought. They didn't see religion as a bad force needing to be eradicated. What White thought was that the intellectual content of Christianity, what's often called theology, had to be discarded. And the moral thrust and ethical thrust of Christianity, he thought, was good. He wanted to see that continue. But he thought that the theology needed to be discarded, left aside, so that science could progress and religion could progress as well. He thought theology was always a negative force in the history of ideas.
Okay, well, I guess one good follow-up question at that point would be, if somebody were to say that, you know, Christian theology is all messed up or wrong or conflicts with science, what would they even be referring to, because there's so many different kinds of Christian theology? I mean, for example, young earth creationism, old earth creationism, evolutionary creationism, they're all Christian theology and they all have radical differences. So what would it even mean?
Well, I'd like to come back to that in a bit and have you ask me about those views again. Those are contemporary views about the origins controversy. That controversy was not full-blown when White and Draper were writing. They took a long view of history. In their view, for the entire history of the church, Christianity had only had one role relative to science. It was holding back the progress of science. That's the big picture they paint.
They also provide a lot of
alleged examples of this taking place. In other words, they have a forest and trees. The forest is the idea that Christianity is always a negative force relative to science, and the trees are specific instances of this that they believe happens. Modern historians just don't buy this. A lot of the trees are wrong, and the whole forest is rotten, if you want to put it that way. Most historians of science who study these things agree with what I just told you.
Okay, so what you're saying is, if I said, okay, I made a criticism that, you know, he was saying we need to throw out Christian theology, but I was saying, what is Christian theology when it's so radically different? And you're saying these radically different forms of theology are rather new, and they didn't, prior to Draper and those guys, I mean, there wasn't all these different varieties? Is that what you're saying?
No, you had mentioned, for example, evolutionary creation as an example, young earth creationism. These are viewpoints that some religious people hold today in the origins controversy. They weren't really thinking about those very much when they were writing in the 19th century.
Yeah, but I mean, what if he said even now
the whole history down through the 19th century, the Middle Ages, the Renaissance, the Scientific Revolution. That's what they were looking at.
Well, I guess part of me is kind of thinking too, like, well, even now, I guess not even that many people are young earth creationists, for example, in the Christian theology, but they're a very loud minority, but they're quite a minority. But I guess that's all new too since the 50s
or so. Well, I actually think young earth creationists might be close to a majority, at least among evangelical Christians. And there's certainly a majority among fundamentalist Christians.
Well, that's interesting. So
that would be today.
That's talking about the masses, though, and not academia, probably, right?
Oh yes, absolutely.
That's so, like, right. There's two different, when you say, what do most Christians believe, it's like two different answers. Do you mean the people in the pew or the people in academia? Because there's a difference there, isn't there?
Oh, there's a very large difference, yes.
Now, why would that be?
Well, one reason for this, I believe, is the fact that since the late 19th century, there's been a growing gap between the expertise, the expert knowledge, what the scientific community thinks, not only what they think about something like, say, evolution or meteorology or medicine, but also what they think of how to get the scientific knowledge in the first place, their knowledge of the scientific method and such. Whereas the ordinary person in America, whether or not they're religious, tends not to understand these things very well at all. They're not an expert, and as the expert knowledge advances, they get further and further lost as an average ordinary person. So there's this gap between the knowledge of the elite, if you want to call them that, and the knowledge of the ordinary person. That's something historian James Gilbert, University of Maryland, has written a nice book about this called Redeeming Culture. And he talks about this gap and how it originates in the late 19th, early 20th century and tends to get worse over time. So that would be a factor.
But you know what's interesting when you talk about this gap, too, there's probably a continuum, see if you agree with this, that where on the one hand you have the scientists or the academic, the theologians and the scientists in Christianity, and then you have the masses. And so you have those on two opposite sides. But in between is the pastors. And so it seems like the pastors are also falling on the side of the masses where, you know, the pastors aren't doing the jobs that the academics would do if they had those jobs.
I think it very much depends on which group of Christians you're looking at. For example, there are seminaries in the United States that actually have quite sophisticated approaches to science and religion. Mm-hmm. One of those places would be the Pittsburgh Theological Seminary, which is a Presbyterian seminary. Princeton, another Presbyterian seminary, has a pretty sophisticated view of this. The Graduate Theological Union in Berkeley, which is a set of close to a dozen seminaries from various denominations, also has a very sophisticated view of this. You know, I could go on, but then, of course, there's other seminaries where people don't really think very much about science and religion, and in some places they're wedded to scientific creationism. So okay. There's such a great variety, it's hard to generalize.
Okay, so I guess to go forward again, another question where you wanted to give some input for some material to discuss is, you wanted to express what your viewpoint is on this warfare view, what are the problems with that view, and then like I said, I probably would agree with this view, and we can talk about that in more detail.
Well, it was common in the late 19th and early 20th century, very, very common for people to view it as Draper and White did, as two contending powers that were just locked in inevitable conflict. You know, what I'd like to do here is just read briefly from a very interesting book that was not written by a Christian believer. It was actually written by a Jewish scholar, a man named Robert Merton. That was really a pen name. His actual original name in the United States was Meyer Skolnick. He was born in Philly as a child of Jewish immigrants. He changed his name to Robert Merton, and he's probably the most famous American sociologist of the last century. His first book, written many, many years ago, made the claim that the scientific revolution was partly a result of Puritan views in England, Puritan religious views, which had a very positive impact on the development and reception of science. He wrote about this in the 1930s, and here's what he recalls. Listen to what he recalls. It's what he's talking about, the context of the time that I think is particularly interesting. What he says is this. If educated and articulate Puritans of the 17th century had been social scientists, they would have found the focus of interest of modern scholars on my claims in this book very strange. I'm paraphrasing a bit, but this is close to exactly what he says. He says they took it almost as self-evident that science made not for the dethronement of God, but rather provided a means of celebrating his wisdom and the tidiness of the universe he had created. That's what he says about the Puritans. But he says when he wrote about this, when Merton himself wrote about this in the 1930s, he puts it like this. He says, the section of my dissertation that dealt with Puritanism focused on what then seemed to many people an improbable, even absurd relation between religion and science. At least among those who had been reared on John Draper and A.D. White, it was widely believed, as some still believe, that the prime historical relation between religion and science is bound to be one of conflict. Then he goes on to say, the only concession made by scholars holding this view was that on occasion, the inherently opposed forces of science and religion were accommodated to each to the other in an effort to dampen the intensity of the warfare. But he goes on then to say that quite another kind of interplay between Protestantism and science was conceived of in this study. He means his own book. And he talks about how religious views in 17th century England were actually an impetus for science. It's a view called the Merton thesis. So the point in quoting all that is just to say, look, you know, here's a scholar reflecting on what was going on in the 1930s when the White and Draper view was really dominant, such that even a truly brilliant sociologist, a Jewish sociologist, writing about Protestantism and science, found it difficult to get a hearing because people just were almost unable to believe that it could have been the case, that religion and science were engaged in positive mutual interaction. That's just an illustration of the mindset at the time that Merton refers to. There's many other writers I could quote to that effect, but he'll suffice for our purposes.
Okay, so I have some questions. I'm not sure if they directly relate to that or not, but I guess the most obvious question I have on all this is, it seems to me you're saying that there is no conflict between science and Christianity, and I don't understand how you can say that, knowing that, for example, you said, I mean, most of the Christians you said are a majority believe in the young Earth creationism, and then even the old Earth creationism rejects evolution, which says that humans evolved from animals. So if those two put together contain most of Christianity, how is there not a conflict? I don't understand that.
Well, that's a very good question. I need to clarify some things. To start with, I was talking about a view widespread in our culture that the whole history of Christianity and science has been one of conflict. That's the view that historians almost unanimously reject. It simply doesn't paint an accurate picture of past events, right down through the 19th century. It is certainly true today that many Christians, particularly fundamentalists and many evangelical Christians, do find themselves objecting to evolution, especially human evolution, and they are engaged, indeed, in a conflict with that particular part of science. So that's true. I mean, we partly agree.
Well, okay. Now, so let me ask you the question this way. So do you personally then believe in evolution, that humans evolved from animals?
I think the evidence for that is very strong.
Okay, so you're going to go with modern science on that?
Yes.
Okay. So then are you saying that everybody who... I guess I'm still unclear. So you're saying if people do not accept that, then yes, there is a conflict with science and religion for them, but it's unfortunate because... In other words, Christians should accept evolution like you do, and that gets rid of the conflict, in biology at least. And if they do not accept the evolution, biological evolution, then they have a conflict, right?
Well, their view would be in conflict with evolution. Yes, it would. The people who do reject it. I mean, obviously, that's what it means. If you reject a particular view and you hold a different one, then your view and the other view are in conflict.
Okay, so I think I've heard from you and some other people that there should be no conflict between science and religion. So I guess what you're saying then, that means that you're advocating that they do accept evolution. The reason
well,
why I'm trying to draw
tell,
this out
I
is
can't
because...
Tell people, what's I that? Can't tell people what to think. People have to think for themselves. But I've explained that what I think, and I've explained what a lot of other people think.
Okay, so you're saying if people reject evolution, then it's unfortunate for Christianity because it's making an unfortunate science-religion conflict.
I think it certainly can for many people, yes.
Well, as long as you reject evolution, then you have a conflict, so...
With that part of science, you would.
Okay.
Yeah, you know, now it's worth pointing out, Truman, that most of the people who... Most Christians accept very large parts of science because... In fact, most parts of science have nothing to do with origins issues. You know, if you take a look at a typical journal, scientific journal, like, say, Nature or Science or the Journal of Molecular Biology or any other journal that you want to cite, for at least most scientific journals don't really focus narrowly on issues related to evolution, especially human evolution. They will publish an article about that from time to time. The large majority of their articles are on completely different areas of science. And in those areas of science, most Christians, fundamentalists, evangelicals, others, have no difficulty with most other sciences. So, to say that there's this conflict between the views of those Christians and the views of scientists, you have to qualify that. Say, well, it's in a certain area most of the time when conflict's going to happen for those folks.
Yeah, you know, I guess what's kind of frustrating to me, too, is, you know, when I was a Christian, I was very interested in apologetics and evangelism, and now, as an atheist, I'm still very interested in the debates because I think it brings forth the best arguments. And it seems to me that in evangelical Christianity, evolution is really avoided a lot. And so some people might even say there's no conflict. Why is there no conflict? Because we don't talk about it. And just to give you one example, as I was looking at the university where you teach, or the Messiah College, and I looked in their biology webpage, and they had a statement on evolution. And in there, they basically said, well, you know, there are different ways to look at this, and, you know, we keep an open mind. But one of the things they actually talked about, too, is not having a definite opinion on old Earth or not. So I was thinking, they can't even... they can't even stand up for science enough to say, yes, the Earth is ancient. I mean, they actually want to say it's a viable option that maybe the Earth and the universe is 6,000 years old.
No, our science faculty don't hold that the Earth is young. Our science faculty don't. What the statement refers to is the fact that the college or the science department doesn't have a formal policy on that would exclude or include a person with a given viewpoint on this. In other words, it's not if you want to put it this way, it's not a litmus test whether a person believes or not doesn't believe in a given statement about that. We're not interested in indoctrinating students at Messiah College. We're interested in letting them think for themselves. So what we really have is a multiple models approach in which we explain a lot of the views to students and let them think it through. That's what we do.
Okay,
if you follow my columns on Biologos, that's an accurate representation of the approach that we take in several of our courses.
Okay, so the alternative would be if their biology department, here's the one line they say, department faculty in general tend to favor models that accept the validity of scientific evidence for an old Earth, but this is not a matter of policy. So what you're saying, you just said you don't indoctrinate people, so you're saying if they did promote an old Earth, like modern science says, you would call that indoctrination and not just teaching science?
No. That's not what I mean. What I mean is there's no actual requirement that a given scientist has to accept an old Earth in order to be to teach science at Messiah. Now, the fact is that we all do, but there's nothing written down or no departmental action taken that would deny a person a position if they were a young Earth creationist, for example.
Right. So basically, so then if you had a geology class or some kind of class like that, it was a science course, and some student wrote on an essay exam, you know, about how the Earth was 6,000 years old and the universe was 6,000 years old, they wouldn't get marked down for that.
No, I don't mark students down for expressing their views and defending them. I mark students down when they don't think about what they say, when they don't think critically about their own view and the view of others.
Well, I think it's kind of interesting where you draw the line there, because, for example, you won't mark them down for expressing a young Earth view, but you would conceivably mark them down if, for example, they had a flat Earth view, because that's just too much of a gross violation.
Well, that issue really doesn't come up.
Right, because it's so obvious.
Yeah. Another way to put this, Truman, if you're a student in my class, I'm not going to force you to believe something that you don't actually believe. I'm going to ask you to explain various positions on the origins issue. Explain them carefully and accurately, and then assess them, and say why you are more persuaded by one position than another. That's what I ask my students to do.
So if a Christian came to you and said, you know, I'm really concerned. I believe that, you know, in the young universe, I believe the universe is 6,000 years old. And some people really bother me about that, but, you know, is it okay to stick to that? You would say that's a fine option. If that's what makes sense to you, that's fine. Just believe that.
I would say that you need to believe what makes the most sense to you, but you need to be able to explain it carefully in your written work in class.
Yeah, I guess the difficulty here is, as a teacher, I would think you'd say, here's some valid options to believe, but some of these are ruled out because they've been invalidated by science, for example. And it seems to me that the right answer should be, well, these have been invalidated by science, therefore you should not believe this. But it sounds like you want to say, well, these are all, you know, if you want to believe it, it's okay, as long as it makes sense to you.
That makes it sound, I think, a little too slack. I hold students to a standard of explaining their view as carefully as they can and defending it against alternatives. So if a student actually believes that the Earth is 6 or 10,000 years old, not 4.65 billion years old, as mainstream science says, I'm not in a position to tell the student they can't believe what they believe. What I am in a position to tell them, though, is that they need to explain what their belief is and why they believe it.
I think one thing I would suggest, though, is
to understand other views and explain those views, even though they don't believe them themselves.
I guess what I'm saying, though, from being a professor, though, you're in the position of saying, I'm sorry, but that has been scientifically disproven.
Students have no doubt that I hold the view that the science showing that the Earth is 4.65 billion years old is solid science. It's not likely to be overthrown. So that they know what I think, but that's not the issue. The issue is, what do they think, and why do they think it?
Okay, so is there anything else you want to cover on this topic?
If anyone would like to see details of my approaches and how I do these things, again, I suggest they go to Biologos and look at my columns on science and the Bible, and they can see the sort of approach that I take to the issue there. They can also take a look at a statement on my webpage at the college about the courses I teach on science and religion. If they'd like to email me, I can send them a URL for that. My email address is just tdavis@messiah.edu. Very simple.
Okay. Let's see. You know, one thing, here's another thing, too, about the science and religion conflicts. One thing I think is Roman Catholicism, for example, Roman Catholics, they consider themselves Christians. They're self-described Christians. And so you have to say, well, you know, sometimes evangelicals say they're not real Christians, but, you know. So anyway, when you look at all the denominations of Christianities, Roman Catholicism is by far the largest. And I went to CatholicAnswers.com one time, and this is where they try to, they're apologists for the Catholic faith. And they said basically, you know, they're open to accepting evolution, that humans evolved from animals, as long as you say at some point there is one man and woman that we all derived from. And in this way, Adam is the father of all. But I would say scientifically, we know the way evolution works. There is no first man and woman. It's not like the first man or woman popped out of an ape. Evolution happens over time and in populations. So it's a falsified theology that says we all descended from one man and one woman. I mean, what do you think about that?
Well, there are various ways in which Catholic scholars would deal with that, and I think it would take us a couple of days to sort those out, and I don't think that's going to be fruitful to do that. Those individuals who hold various different ways of doing that, they can speak for themselves. I'm not going to go further with that.
Okay, the way I understand
it's not a view that I'm bound to hold, and I may have a different view of that. But one of the factors in their view, Truman, one of the factors in their view is not related to evolution. One of the factors in their view is that they would hold that the human identity is something which is which transcends the physical body and is provided directly by God to the individual. You know, the traditional view of a soul. That is their view. Now, the Pope recently said that evolution is more than a hypothesis, by which he meant that Catholics shouldn't just oppose evolution in the way in which young Earth creationists do. But at the same time, the Pope and other Catholics who follow him don't believe that everything reduces simply to the physical, that there is an element which transcends the physical.
Okay,
it's not a view anyone can prove or disprove. It's a view that is out there. There are alternative views on that sort of thing, as I'm sure you know.
Well, yeah, I was referring to Catholic.com, and they were showing this one quote from the Pope, and he was saying basically there's two different alternatives on how evolution could have happened. Or, you know, one idea is that humans did evolve in a population over time, and he basically was saying that is not an option. Now, that's not in the catechism. That's true. So it's not really official, and so I don't know how much weight it has when he says it's not an option, because he's not speaking ex cathedra and all that. But let's say, for example, a Catholic does say, let's say a Catholic bishop, for example, he does say, oh, that's what the Pope said, and I believe the Pope. So are you saying that, would you agree with me that belief is a science-religion conflict, because we know from evolution that we did not evolve physically from one man and one woman?
Well, the question really is, what constitutes humanity? When did humanity appear? And it's difficult to tell from the fossil record, for example, when the image of God appears in human history. I'm sure you're familiar with the term the image of God, and it means different things to different people, but it's difficult to tell where that would appear in the history of humanity.
But we do
I'd like to ask you some questions or talk about some other things.
Okay, I just wanted to make the point here, though,
that
we're
very interested in evolution.
Yeah, hold on, though. I just want to make really clear, though, that I think from a scientific standpoint, we do know for sure that all humans did not evolve physically from one man and woman. So I just wanted to make that clear. And then if a theology does believe that, then that I think we should say that's an obvious science-religion conflict.
Well, I would hesitate ever to say that we know some things for sure from science, if you mean like it can never be overturned or we're going to be absolutely certain of this. Science,
yeah, I mean, I think we can be. Yeah, I mean, Dennis Vinema talked about this, too. There's no way. And, you know, Dennis Lamoureux, too, he says there is no atom, just like there is no firmament, you know. That there are even Christian theologians now saying that it is not a possibility that there is no Adam, there is no Eve, literally.
Well, this isn't news. This isn't news. It may be news that some evangelical theologians are pushing this, when in the past they would not have. But it's not news that Christian theologians in general would be saying this.
Yeah, but see, my point is if they're not saying that, then they have a science-religion conflict, because I'm, in my viewpoint, the science is clear. So we could disagree on that. I guess you're saying the science is not clear.
It's saying the science is clear is a far different thing from saying the science is absolutely certain.
Okay, so your viewpoint...
Science is not capable of giving us absolutely certain knowledge.
So you don't think science is certain on that, and I do think that science is certain that we did not evolve from one man and woman couple, so that's a difference of opinion we have, right?
No. You're differing with me, I think, on what we mean by certain. You know, for the whole history of science, very few theories are the same as they were 300 years ago. And that's likely to continue in the future. So scientific knowledge changes over time.
Yes.
I'm hesitant ever to say that it's certain.
Yeah, but, I mean, the change is usually more refinement. Yeah, but, okay,
usually that's the case, but sometimes entire views get overturned, as I'm sure you know, such as when Einstein replaced Newton's theory of gravitation.
Yeah.
General relativity.
But what I mean by refinement is I think they're, like, closer and closer to reality. Like, they're not going to go backwards. Like, we're not going to go back to geocentricity from heliocentricity kind of thing.
Well, I think it is unlikely that we'd go back to a geocentric picture. I think that's very unlikely. We agree about that. But, you know, for example, when Einstein proposed in the early 20th century, what's called now the quantum theory of light, that's not what he called it, but that's what we call it now, it was really a reversion in some ways to the old particle view of light from the 17th century, which was thought to have been overturned forever in the 19th century, when everyone sort of knew that light is a wave and doesn't consist of particles in motion. So ideas that are long thought to be dead can come back again. Now, we're digressing here, okay. But I would just say that I don't like to apply the word certain to scientific knowledge. I would say the evidence is very strong. It looks like it's true. We would agree about that. But I don't think you can ever really know for sure.
Okay, so we would just have a difference of opinion on that. So you wanted to ask me a question about... So basically my viewpoint now is naturalism. And, you know, one thing I'm curious when I talk to evangelicals who are experts in science or religion, I would like to know what kind of weakness they see, if any, in my viewpoint, my philosophy or whatever. So... Is that what you want
to
bring?
I think naturalism is a very good principle to hold in science, but there's different kinds of naturalism. If one holds a complete metaphysical naturalism in which the universe is all that ever is, all that ever is, ever was, or ever will be, as Carl Sagan once put it, I don't think that's true. In fact, I'd say there's at least a couple different pieces of evidence or lines of thinking that would suggest that there's more than just nature. One would be the fact that the universe itself appears to be a pretty special universe. And you're probably familiar with the idea of fine-tuning of the universe.
Right.
The fact that the universe really does look as though, as one thinker has put it, Freeman Dyson, a physicist, who is not a Christian believer, has said that the universe knew we were coming in some sense. used the phrase, knew we were coming.
Well,
and the other area would be the very possibility of science itself. It seems to me that on a non-theistic view of the world, it's very, very hard to understand why science is possible at all. I'll put it this way. Albert Einstein once said, the most incomprehensible thing about the world is that it is comprehensible. He was asking, why does the world make sense at all?
Yeah,
and
well...
For a theist, it's kind of like, well, duh. It ought to, because it's created by God, whose reason is like ours, and it ought to be possible for us to understand the universe to a significant degree. That's not something Christians pause and ask themselves why the universe is understandable. We expect it will be. Not completely, because God's thoughts are higher than ours, and there's ways in which the universe, the way it's made, is going to be beyond our understanding. But we should expect to be able to understand a great deal of it, because
I guess some comments I would have is, one is, you know, you said the universe appears special in the fine-tuning argument.
Yes.
One thing I wanted to relate was, first of all, I think the multiverse theory is very compelling, and a lot of evangelicals say, like, oh, that's just an atheistic, you know, alternative. But, you know, I wanted to let them know that there's even Christians, like, we know the one scientist at Baylor University, a Christian university, I talked to him at one of the conferences, and he's very dedicated to multiverse theory based on string theory, which, because he's a physicist, you know, working on that. So, you know, it's like string theory, it's not just for atheists, or multiverse theory, it's not just for atheists.
I agree with you, Truman, that there are Christians who actually are researching multiverse. One of them, as you've referred to, is at Baylor. His name's Gerald Cleaver. Is that the person you meant?
Yeah.
Yeah. And another one would be Stephen Barr, a prominent Catholic physicist at University of Delaware. And a third would be Don Page, who teaches at a Canadian university. He was a student of Stephen Hawking.
Well, you know,
all three of those people are Christians, and they do research on various types of multiverse. There are a number of them.
Yeah, you know, and I read one of these books on the multiverse. I can't remember who wrote it. It might have been Valenkin. It's more than 5 years old, I think. But one of the interesting ideas he had in there, too, is, you know, you talk about this fine-tuning where there's these certain constants that are in the right range to make life possible. But he had an interesting term. He says, you know, even though they're in that range, they're also mundane values. In other words, you know, it's not like the number is 666 or 777 or something. It's some random kind of a number in there. And to give an illustration of that, I went to a presentation one time by Brian Greene, who's a famous physicist. He does the TV specials on multiverse and stuff. And he gave this story.
He's a string theorist.
Yeah, and he gave this interesting story one time where he said one time he brought his kid into the shoe store, and I think his kid was like 8 years old or even younger maybe, and he saw the shoe he liked, and so he goes, okay, let's ask the clerk if he has this in a size 3 or whatever you have. So the clerk went back in the back room and says, yeah, here, I got one. So he put it on, they bought it. And then when he was driving home in the car, his son said, boy, Dad, we were really lucky. And he goes, why is that? And he goes, oh, because they had my shoe size there. So the boy thought, you know, they were just lucky, but he didn't realize that they had all of these different versions, you know, in the back just ready to be taken. So in the same way, I think the fine-tuning, the people, there could be a problem here where the people who are impressed by the fine-tuning think, oh, there's one number, wow, that's amazing. But when you realize there's actually a whole range of those numbers, and maybe different universes have different ranges or different numbers, the you know, it takes away that specialty.
Well, you know, we're a long way from knowing whether the multiverse is true at all, and there's many problems with it. For example, the string theory you refer to, no one really knows if it's true.
Right.
It's not presently testable.
Right.
And so presently it's a world on paper. The famous book that Galileo wrote called the Dialogues on Two Chief World Systems, which was about Copernicus and Ptolemy, he has a line in there where he says that our discourses must relate to the sensible world and not to one on paper. I would echo that. Right presently, the form of multiverse coming out of string theory, is a world on paper. We don't really know that it's true, and it's very, very speculative.
Right.
And it may remain that way for a long time.
But at least it does...
No, I don't regard that as science yet. It may prove to be science eventually, but right now it's just mathematical speculation.
Yeah, the way I see it, you know, the way humans evolved, you know, at one point in our evolution, we knew nothing of science, and there it was all philosophy. We just had ideas about how things happened, and you put these ideas, and then the scientific method we have, where you have your hypothesis, and you do an experiment, and look at results, and see if you should revise your hypothesis. What happens is we start to get data, and then the philosophy starts to dissipate, and the data becomes stronger. So the philosophy kind of turns into science as we progress and get more knowledge. So it's interesting to me that the string theory, you know, I mean, the multiverse, at least it's got a basis in math or something, rather than just something, I mean, what's the alternative? It's just like, well, I don't know, therefore God did it kind of thing. It's leaning on God as a bookmark for saying, I don't know.
Well, it's actually much, much different from that in my view. It's taking science and placing it within a larger philosophical, or if you will, metaphysical framework in which science itself makes sense. I mean, the multiverse is only deals with the fact that the universe really does appear to be finely tuned for the existence of living things. And it's very hard to understand how that could be in a classical picture of the universe. I mean, Alan Sandage, one of the great astronomers of the 20th century, once said that, you know, the universe looks like a one-shot deal. He said it comes close to saying that the universe was created. It's unique. He put it one that way in an interview. It does look that way. Now, there's other forms of multiverse as well. There's some that are really crazy, coming out of Hugh Everett's interpretation of quantum mechanics, in which every time a quantum function collapses, as physicists say, it produces a result, and the alternative results also are produced somewhere else in some other universe. That strikes me as an almost absurd view, in which almost anything goes.
So right,
if that view is correct, then somewhere, Truman, there's a universe in which I'm an atheist and you're an evangelical Christian.
Right. I know, like, in the universe somewhere, there's Richard Dawkins preaching the gospel, too.
Yeah, exactly.
I also think it sounds ridiculous. But you're also saying that the multiverse theory is tied up in the philosophy also, but maybe that could be disproven by the fact that there's evangelical Christians who believe in it, not just atheists.
No. What that means is that it simply means that some Christians are interested in it as well and are researching it. That's simply just the case. It doesn't make the theory true, and it doesn't make it false. But it does mean that it's not inherently an atheistic view.
Yeah, so basically it means, I mean, it shows that it is not ideologically driven, though.
It doesn't mean that many people might believe it. It doesn't mean that many people wouldn't believe it, perhaps for ideological reasons. I think there are some who might believe it for ideological reasons. I suspect that's true. But they may approach it in a different way than someone like Stephen Barr or Gerald Cleaver.
Okay, so, you know,
the further problem with the multiverse in general is that any form of multiverse presently, to the best of my knowledge, cannot be shown to be confirmed by an observational result. If an observational result is possible for any of the forms, and it might be possible for one, according to George Ellis, who's one of the leading cosmologists today,
then
it would only be able to be shown that it's not true if we could make that observation.
Have you heard of...
Something Ellis told me last year when I had a chance to sit down and talk to him. He explained there was one type of multiverse that might be testable in the future if we could make certain observations, but if we made those observations, it would turn out to falsify that view, and that there's no present way of showing that it might be true.
It's a different
version of multiverse.
One thing that's pretty interesting is how brilliant scientists are, and they come up with ideas. Like, one thing I've heard, you know, from the very start when I first heard multiverse, I've heard people say, like, well, there's no way to prove that it's true. But I heard one way that scientists are actually looking is that there's the idea that if we have a universe and there's another universe, there's a possibility they had a collision. And if they had a collision, we might be able to detect that in the cosmic microwave background. And so they're actually looking at and analyzing it and using calculations to see what the cosmic microwave background would look like under such a collision, and then see if they, in fact, actually see that. There's at least one scientific paper written on that, I think. Have you heard of that one?
I have not heard that. I'd like to see that paper.
Yeah, so, I mean, that just strikes me as really clever. It's kind of mind-boggling, too, because, you know, another universe out of our reality and all that.
Well, that would be important if we could do that. If we could actually have some detectable form of a multiverse prediction, that would be very interesting.
Yeah, it's kind of funny how they say, too, like bruising in our cosmic microwave background. You know, it makes sense that there's another universe and we collided with them at one point.
Yes.
So yeah, let me
raise some other questions. We were talking about the fine-tuning, which is one feature of the universe, but the other feature that of the universe I want to talk about is the possibility of science itself. When I quoted that statement from Einstein about the most incomprehensible thing is that the world's comprehensible at all, that's an interesting statement. You know, why should we be able to make sense of the universe? Or more specifically, let me quote another scientist who was also not a Christian, I do not know whether he was religious at all. His name is Eugene Wigner, and he was a Hungarian. I understand a friend of his told me once that when he came to the United States and took American citizenship, he changed it to Wigner. But Eugene Wigner is his given name. And he put it this way once in a fascinating paper that you can easily find on the Internet. He wrote a paper in 1960 called The Unreasonable Effectiveness of Mathematics in the Natural Sciences. And here's a sentence from that. He said, "It is difficult to avoid the impression that a miracle confronts us here, quite comparable in its striking nature to the two miracles of the existence of laws of nature and of the human mind's capacity to divine them." He was really asking the question, why is mathematics such a powerful tool for understanding nature way down deep? Why that? Why mathematics? Why is nature so mathematical? And a third question also related to these two. By another scientist who was, again, not a Christian believer, Paul Dirac, one of the greatest physicists of the 20th century. He put it this way, "God used beautiful mathematics in creating the world. This result is too beautiful to be false. It is more important to have beauty in one's equations than to have them fit experiment." Here's a mathematical physicist that said, not only do we need mathematics to understand nature, we need a certain kind of mathematical equations that people who have studied a lot of advanced mathematics refer to as beautiful. It's hard to explain what that means if you haven't studied a lot of mathematics. But
a long time ago,
I studied physics, and I have a sense of that.
Yeah, you know, like for example, people could say the beauty of E equals mc squared, and that does seem really beautiful because it's so simplified. It's like Google or Apple products; they're very simple too and easy to use. But you know, it's interesting when you look at the actual equation for that. It's very, very complicated with square roots and everything. But it's just that when you plug in some variables for a lot of it falls out, and you can say equals mc squared for certain conditions, I believe.
Yeah, well, I would say that equations with square roots in them aren't usually very considered to be very beautiful or complicated. But there's a standard example of what mathematicians often mean by a beautiful equation. And let me write it out for a second on paper, and then I'll read it to you. I'm just going to make sure I have it written out first. Okay, so if listeners have a piece of paper, I'll read it slowly, and then they can write it out, and some of them will recognize this. You start with E, the letter E, which, of course, is an important mathematical constant. Then you put an exponent on it, letter I and the letter pi. Pi is very familiar to people. So E to the power I pi plus 1 equals 0. It's 7 symbols going across, left to right. E to the power I pi plus 1 equals 0. Mathematicians love that equation and describe it as beautiful, because it contains 7 of the most important mathematical symbols all in one equation. And it's a very simple equation. It's one quantity plus the unity equals 0. Everything negates. And that type of mathematics, that the sense that this is very, very simple and yet very, very profound. There's so much loaded into that.
Well, yeah,
so this idea of beauty.
Yeah, so let me give an example of this. Suppose this is one example I just have going on in the background of my thought processes. when you look at about how, look at how humans evolved, you know, at some point we're Neanderthals or even before that, and we don't really know anything. And people are going around saying, hey, there was thunder last night and lightning. Who did that? And everybody goes, we have no idea. We know elephants, when they run, I can feel the ground shake. Let's say an earthquake. So we feel the ground shake. You know, it was such a big shaking, bigger than an elephant stampede. Obviously, something big made that. There must be a god. And now we know that was wrong. It was not made by God. It was made by plate tectonics. So God had nothing to do with that. As we get smarter and smarter, now we discover the equations and all that. It seems to me like it's very easy to ascribe all that. Like, where'd that come from? Oh, again, you ascribe everything to God. And then the more you learn, you start to find out more as we progress. And I don't think we're at the peak of our intelligence at all. I think, you know, we have a long ways to go. So if we are at the peak of our intelligence, then we could maybe give glory to God because we can't figure it out. But if we're learning creatures and are ignorant to begin with, why should we ascribe it to God, just like the Neanderthals who did that for earthquakes?
Well, Truman, the significance of the points I've been making about mathematics and the understandability of the universe is that it's not being said out of human ignorance. It's being said the opposite, about how much we know about the universe. The more we actually know about the universe, the more it seems to be the case that it's comprehensible and that the way in which we comprehend it is using beautiful mathematics. Now, why should that be so? I mean, mathematics itself is not something that primitive humans could do. Not the kind of high-powered mathematics known as beautiful mathematics. This is something that only has come out in modern times. It's not necessary for our evolutionary survival to be able to do higher mathematics. It's something that we need to look into the deep mysteries of the universe, but it's nothing that we needed to survive.
Okay, so
It doesn't have survival value, in other words.
Okay, so I think we'll have to leave it there because we're nearly out of time. How about I give you 30 seconds to give a summary if you want to, and then I'm going to skip my summary, and I'm just going to follow up with some local gatherings here.
Well, I would say that the point I'd like to get across is that the more we know about the universe, the more it seems to be a great thought, as a great cosmologist once said. And it's not clear on a non-theistic view why the universe should be comprehensible and why it should be comprehensible through mathematics, which seems like a set of eternal truths, transcending nature, and why it seems to be that we need to use beautiful mathematics. It seems like a great work of art. So that's what I'd like to get across.
All right, Ted. Thanks for calling in. I enjoyed our conversation, and I got a few seconds here left, so I want to tell our audience about, if you basically want to find out more about me, you can go on Facebook and look for Truman Ardent Smith. At Twitter, it's the @Truman_Smith. And if you want to find out more about atheism or agnosticism and local groups that are gathering, you can go to meetup.com, and they list all kinds of groups. If you put in atheist or agnostic, you'll find all these different groups that pop up. For example, there's Humanists of Greater Portland, which is a chapter of the AHA, American Humanist Association. There's also CFI, the Center for Inquiry, which has a Portland chapter. They have Flying Spaghetti Monster Lands for a Pint, where people get together and atheists and agnostics and talk in a tavern. There's another group called Atheists, Etc. They meet at various places. And Portland State University has a free thinkers group. So with that, we'll end the show. And again, Ted, thanks for being on, and bye to the audience.
Good night, and thank you for the opportunity to talk about these topics, Truman.
All right.
I wish you well.
All right, thanks. Bye.
Bye-bye.